Very thankful for what you've history and should tell, then all the words will be around. So they are much more interesting than I am in my history. So then I pick up those two words, metaphor and irony, as the two highlights. But when I was thinking further, then I realized that it's not only about metaphor, it's not only about irony, it's even not only about artistic things, but it's very deeply about Polish history, especially of the history of the last 60 or 50 years. So the history that happened to begin after the Second World War, and fortunately it ended in 1989 in the form we knew. So we will start this history with this first phrase, the how everyday reality became the metaphor that describes political reality. You can see it here, from the right to the left. We have beautifully presented, thanks to Amanda, works by Professor Mieczysław Feynman. He was the father of Stanisław Feynman, and he was the founder of two key things related to printmaking, not only in Krakow. First one was the Department of Graphic Arts, of course, at the Fine Arts Krakow Academy, but also a printmaking school that was based in Krakow. A school, I mean, you know, a group of people who are somehow joined by common ideas. But he was also one of the four founders of International Print Biennale in Krakow in 1966. And this is an event that I still have an honor now to represent. So when we start this journey with his first work, that is in fact the second work from the series Cyclist, we can see at first a common image. There is a man who just fell out of his bicycle because probably he was not very conscientious what he is doing. But look at those men at the ladder. They are, even though they notice that he fell, but they do not help him. He is there alone. And it's very important that this series is dating 1964. It was a very strange period. After 1953, when Stalin died, we have this a kind of period that was called the thaw, this moment when the ice is melting because the spring came. But it ended very quickly, and it left a kind of situation that was afterwards, just in 1964, named by one of the Polish writers and theater writers, Tadeusz Różewicz, our small stabilization. I think it's very significant that in the same year, 1964, this work was made together with almost all the others, almost, it's also important, and Tadeusz Różewicz published his theatrical drama entitled The Witnesses or Our Small Stabilization. What was this small stabilization? It was something that was also at that period described by very famous later on famous film directors, Roman Polanski and Jerzy Skolimowski. They made their diplomas in 1960 and 1961. And both of those diplomas were related to this small stabilization. A history of young generation that has really some things like small cars. In 1955, they started to produce the FSO siren, a kind of a car that was available for some people at least. So, and also some motors were provided for young people, and some people were allowed to listen and to play jazz music, and so on and so on. And both of them, Roman Polański and Jerzy Skolimowski, described a generation that, well, is the kind of majority, because in at the turn of the 50s into 60s, it was 40% of all Polish people given some things that, well, made them think that, oh, everything is all right. We can, well, we can go with it. No one is, in fact, bothering us. We can almost do what we want. And they were living in such a condition until 1967. It was a huge student movement around the world. You have your own here in America. The French has their own. And also we in Poland have our own, but it was different. It was different not only because there was a lot of Polish people associated themselves Polish, but named the Jews who should go to Israel and throw away the country. But there was also a lot of problems at that time with freedom, with free speech. The first moment when the students uprised was the moment when one of the theatrical show was just postponed. It was the 19th century drama by Adam Mickiewicz. But some authorities thought that, oh, it's dangerous because there are some political things in it that we shouldn't speak loudly today. And I'm saying so much about it because an entire cycle is first of all about the small stabilization and go through it. Look at those people. Look at this girl. Like we are in the 20s of the 20th century. She's in a beautiful dress. Probably she's at a party or there is a kind of a meeting. Everyone's rather interested in what's going on somewhere there. No one is noticing this man who just fell for another time. We can compare it with many things. We can compare it with the crucifixion way. And it was compared with it many times by politicians and by artists also. And it just what going on. One day also said that he was very much inspired by the work of Albert Dürer while he was working on the cyclist. But even the worker that is here probably, even though he is seeing what happened, he's also not very much interested in what's happening. Why is that? Because to be individual in communism time is something that no one was interested in. It's better to be in a group. It's better to be with somebody. And if you are individual, well, you've got your own problems. Get away from here. You can feel a little bit further there, you know, when we cannot see you. It's better for us. I think that there is no better metaphor of what little stabilization really made to people, what it made them to be, than this series of works. And look at this. Okay, we can believe that somebody who is partying is not interesting in somebody who just fell out of the bike. We can believe that the workers that are doing something are uninterested. But look at this print. It's another cyclist who is standing there. And he's also uninterested. He does not have. And the man is just, we don't know what he's doing. He's not uprising his hand in order to get some help, but he's rather saying, oh my God, no, please don't. Well, leave me alone. I know that you can even more harm me than this falling off of the bicycle did. And look here. He's now totally alone. But for me, the most important is this last word that I can see here on my left side. You will see it in a minute here. It is important because of two reasons. Look at the date. It's 1970. Something very important and very awful, horrified happened at that year. For the first time since 1956, in fact, for the first time from the war, people in Poland, this young generation, not only the young generation of intellectuals, but young generation of workers too, start to think, okay, maybe we should change something. Something is going wrong. We don't like the way it is. We would like to change it. Of course, there were students who protested 3 years ago, but nothing saying, you are the most important, the workers are most important. So maybe if we do something, they will listen to us. Well, they haven't. It was 1970 in Gdańsk, where a lot of people died. A lot of workers died that was associated with the shipyards. Because they uprised, because they said, we do not want it this way. And look at this man. If we watch this previous works, we still see that the man is alive. Here, I'm not very sure. I don't know what happened. Mm-hmm. I, even if it's scary, I don't want really know precisely. I still prefer to believe that he survived. But there will be some optimism in a minute, because I'm strongly looking there, I strongly believe that he survived. But he's lying, there is no one there, everything is broken. And this cult is very important. This cult will return in the younger generation of printmakers, of course. Well, it's impossible not to notice that one of the very important for the artist himself works by Stanislaw Feynman, that was made in 1977, is called The Coat. Of course, it looks a little bit different, but when I had this one of many conversations that we have with Professor Feynman, he said, you know, it's strange, because before this, he asked me which of his work I would like to have. And I said, well, definitely this one. And, well, it happened. It's now hanging at my bedroom. And he said, you know, it's strange that you've chosen this one because it's very important to me. I tried to be a little bit different than my father, but he's quite different in artistic, of course, when I speak about his artistic interest. But this one was somehow dedicated to him. Because I was so much taken by his cyclist that, of course, I do not want to repeat it. So I did something else, and this was the quote, because I still remember this quote from the 1970. So, what we see here, we see a man without a hat who is going through the street, the wind is blowing, everything is flying everywhere, but he still try to stand. He still is standing and he still tried to go somewhere. And in 1977 they really try once again, even though what happened in 1970, they still try to go on. And they will, succeed. So here we can see another work by Professor Stanislaw Feynman. And even though it's a little bit different, aesthetics than the previous one, but it is also very important. You can see here the aquatine that look a little bit like poster, a little bit like lithography, or maybe even silkscreen. And it's because, of course, it's color. There are colors used. That's an important thing. Now the color appears in printmaking works. When we were checking the equipment before the lecture, there was the problem, oh my god, we need some colors. I said, okay, there will be later, because the first part is definitely black and white. So the manier noir. Now we are entering the colorful world. But if we look very closely, I can feel a kind of a rush. Because 1980 was, of course, a great year, you know. Solidarity, Lech Wałęsa, Czesław Miłosz received the Nobel Award. Everything seemed to be beautiful. Everything seemed, well, for the first time to be fine. Well, we won it. Told all the people who were in Gdańsk, but also all the other people in all the other part of, of Poland. But there was some kind of anxiety just beneath the surface. We can feel it in the rush in which Andrzej Wajda completed the Man of Iron, that won the Palme d'Or in Cannes and was nominated to Oscars, to the Academy Award for the foreign language film. And it was released for just fading, it's going away. So 1981 was a very strange year, and I can really feel this. Before the smile dies on the lips, of course, you can associate it also with everyday life, with some things that happened to Stanislaw Lem, and there are also some private stories behind. But since I'm not very eager to go to the private shoes of professor, I prefer to look at this work as a kind of announcement. What happened on the, not necessarily on the 13th of December 1981, so the introduction of the martial law that cut everything down, but a kind of anxiety that there was, as I said, beneath the surface. So we are going further, and we have a work that was made in 1984. The martial law is over. It was over, it ended in 1983. But Jan Wolnowski is working on a series that has nothing in common with politics. The series is rather focused on the, well, the gardens of his friends. And 2 weeks before I came here, I had the opportunity to speak with Jan Wolnowski because I noticed that, well, probably later on the problem was solved, but that, this was the moment when I noticed in the papers from Amanda that there is some kind of trouble with the title of this work as well as the technique. So the title was easier for me since it is written down in the bottom part of the work, so it's black stone, but it was harder to predict whether it's aquatint, aquaform, or anything else, or maybe metal, whatever. So I met with Jan accidentally. He just came to one of the openings we organized at Trinia, and I asked him, and immediately he said, oh, it was etching an aquatint. Well, you so well remember that it was so many years ago. I said, yes, I remember this work very well. Because it was the only one from the entire series that was not, well, of course, it was based on sandstone, that stones that I found in my friend's garden. But this one is solemnly dedicated to the martial law and to the feelings I had when the martial law was introduced. Look at the dates. He was born in 1951, so in 1981, he was just a man of his 30s. He was a young man at the beginning of his artistic career, and now the country in which he was living was closed. Of course, it was not very open before, but still artists had some opportunities to go out. And now everything was closed. Passports were somewhere there, not in our pockets, not in our drawers. It wasn't that easy as it is today. So he said, yeah, it is an important work, and I can also feel it when I look at it, because this black stone is totally different than all the other works from the stone series that he made. It is really dominating. It is something that, you know, made me feel like, oh my God, I'm crushed. That was something that fell over me. And even though there is no cyclist anymore, but still there is a strong metaphor that he and his generation inherited from Professor Mittelman. So now, Andrew Peach, he will be ending this story somehow about the 80s and about the political metaphor. Black and red, now, I suppose, very well aware that we have white and red national flag. But here we have black and red, and here we have a kind of, well, this red is somewhere there. There is, of course, a lot of white in the upper part. But it is this black that dominates the red. We don't know whatever is the grass of the traces of blood. What's going on in this print? Still we don't know, but we think that it's not the print, or we can feel that it's not the print of the funny times or sympathetic times. Okay, now there will be a little break from the history, but we will return to this. How intimate and personal might become common experience. I took only two artists to this part. Czech Republic, a very exceptional printmaker. Well, he was at the Fine Arts Academy for only one semester, and he was thrown away because he was absolutely unable, you know, to get, you know, to this system, even though the system was much more lighter than it is now. All those, you know, things that we have to achieve, and we have to write down that, oh, we had so many exhibitions, we did so many papers, and so and so, and so many conferences. But Jerzy Pandek was absolutely a free spirit. And by free spirit, I also mean his attitude to printmaking. Even though here at the exhibition you can see his prints, and even though here is the reproduction of print, but he definitely was much more dedicated to the matrix itself. The matrix, so this something that at that time, the time when he was active, was rather an obscure object that was in the artist's studio. And he was the first one who said, all right, if you are making my exhibitions, so please show the matrices. Otherwise, it's no use. And then he went. And it was like that, because I remember Professor Tomalski, who's he's now at the Fine Arts Academy for ages, but he was also in a very close friendship relation with Jerzy Pandek, and he was like a print master for Jerzy Pandek, because he was really uninterested in making this print into being. The matrix was absolutely a universe for him, especially he was working with the wood. So he said that, oh, I can feel very similar, it was a very similar phrase to what Professor Lutomsky used to say, that wood is a warm matrix, on the contrary to the linen cut. And you were rather with a very, very cold matrix, because linen is just the artificial thing, and wood is natural. Mm-hmm. And when the triennial, Professor Witold Skulich, who was the first president of our society, was organizing the Japanese exhibition in the National Museum in Krakow, the most important elements of these exhibitions were matrices. They showed almost all of them, and they reproduced almost all of them in the catalog. The prints were there, of course, too, but they were not so important as the matrices. But that intimate and personal became a common experience. The proof of it, I don't know whether it would be visible, but here is something that you can really read. It's well, maybe not well pronounced, but it's definitely related to Professor Macoka. And this is the experience of Jerzy Pandek, an experience of friendship, of meeting of Professor Macoka. But we in Krakow know that this experience, this you know, this friendship was something that a lot of other artists shared with Jerzy Pandek. That's why I chose this word to speak about something that is very personal, but can be universalized. And definitely, this is the idea that, according to me, very well described the words of Anna Sobolevna. She's always coming from the intimate, from her own very intimate experiences. Even if they are everyday, or sometimes I refer to people with whom she interferes, but I don't know how is she doing it, besides the fact that perfectly, but she's turning it into a kind of prints that contains feelings. I really don't know how it's possible, but it's not about the image. In case of Stanislaw Weyman, it's still about the image. In her case, it's about emotions, and she found her way to express emotions. Each work you can, each work you see by her, it is so full of emotions that showing these words in such a way is just a kind of doing them harm. So it's better just to stand in front of those words and be their soul, you know, work and nothing. And even if at the beginning you think, oh my god, what's that? Well, you know, Paul Klee or some kind of abstraction. No, don't look at this work like that. Because it's not the notation ideas, it's the notation of emotions. And I will be definitely stand very strongly on this feeling that she has the key to visualize the emotions. I don't know how, as I said, I don't know how she's doing it, but she's doing it perfectly. And then the second word that I chose for today, isn't it ironic? Of course, some, especially the younger, probably know this phrase from a famous pop song. But it was like that, because the pop was very important. There was a generation in the academy that grown up with the, of course, old professors. They were taught by them, they learned from them, but they also would like to be themselves. And it was very hard to, you know, to make uprising, an artistic uprising. I remember my talk with Professor Henryk Orszuk. He said to me, no, the only way to really stood against was to use a lot of colors and to use you know, a kind of aesthetics that was very close to German expressionism. It was the only thing that we could do. Of course, they did it in a different way, and I think that more important was the color, and especially a lot of colors that they used. The examples are not exactly the good illustration. I will explain why. Because Jacek Sropak is definitely a colorist. He's a printmaker, he's a painter, and he's doing an extremely interweaving of colors, like yellow with some colors that definitely shouldn't go with yellow together, not that close. But he's doing it, and he's doing it in a great manner. But here we only have this very small work by him, the work from a huge series related to, of course, a very famous Latin text, but also related to martial law. So this is Malleus Maleficarum, so Hammer Against the Witches. But this, what I would like to say about this work, is definitely, even though it's still black and white, and I can imagine how it would look when it would be colorful, this, what I would like to say, is that we can feel this grotesque and satire and irony in it. This was, well, different generation. By different, I don't mean better. It was just different. They would like at least to have some fun. Even in this not very good times, they just would like to look with the irony of things, not being so serious, but still, they were from Krakow School of Printmaking. You cannot just throw away all your history, you cannot throw away everything the professors were talking with you about, and especially Mieczysław Weimar. He had a very great way of making so-called corrections. He never made a formal correction. He never, you know, take a word of the student saying, oh, you should maybe do this line like that. No. It was always a discussion about an important things, about the ideas that he foreseen in the work of a student, even though the student hadn't seen it yet. It was amazing. You know, 2 weeks ago, Professor Grzegorz Onuszkiewicz just opened his huge exhibition in Krakow. He's now in his 70s. Had this conversation on the radio, on Krakow radio, and during this conversation, he recalled Professor Mieczysław Weimar and the way, you know, the man is now, as I said, 70 or maybe 71. He still remembers how it was when Mieczysław Weimar started the correction. I said, you know, it was incredible. And he always remembered what he told to the student, and he was able to get back to this discussion, for example, 3 or 4 weeks later. The student sometimes didn't remember what it was about. But the professor always remembered. I said, you know, I will think it over. And now I think that maybe you were right, but. So it's absolutely incredible. And you know, it's very hard to say, okay, we are throwing it away, we are not interested, old professor. the metaphor survived this change. And we can see it very good in works like this. Piotr Kunze, who was mainly associated with silkscreen and the green and the poster studio, but here you have a very good cinematography by him. Let's say Alice in Wonderland. And this, what they introduced, was, as I said, a kind of a play, a kind of a joy, but also a strangeness, a kind of surrealistic game, an expressionism's game. It depends on, you know, the personality of the younger generation. Of course, he was born in 1942, so you say, well, younger. Well, but he was associated with a special studios. And that was important because he was one of those who introduced the posters, he was one of those who introduced graphic design, he was one of those who introduced other techniques than intaglio or the relief techniques. So he was modern by nature and he was very open. So that's why he was rather more with the youngers than with the olders. And here you have Jerzy Dmitruk, 1986. And I think also a very important work, theater. At first we can see a little bit of grotesque, a little bit of irony in it, a lot of colors, even though there are more, in majority reds, but in different shades. But this is also a kind of metaphor, because 80s were really awful. Majority of Polish people felt like, oh my god, we're on the stage, what are we doing here? We did everything already and nothing happened. You know, I think that there were very few people who believed that something will really change any someday, whatever, but this belief is very important in order to go on, and they don't have it. They just don't have it. Well, they didn't have it because there were so many bad things before. So many bad things happened. The fate was almost gone. And we can see it, maybe I will demonstrate to get to this theater. Because there is also something that was important then in the 1989. The society was fed up, even though we were enthusiastic about what happened. But on the other hand, we were a little bit fed up, but still there was this, oh no, no, maybe it's only for a minute, maybe not. Maybe it won't last as it didn't last in the past. So now here is this great race, and I can feel like a subject of this print. Even though it was made in 1989, and I was 10 at that time, but I was one of those who were supposed to go in this great race. We didn't know where to run. I sometimes, of course, not in the 80s, but more in the late 90s, I felt really like Forrest Gump. Like this moment when the mother is screaming, run, Forrest, run, okay, but where? We didn't know. Our parents were saying to us, you know, it's a new world. We don't know how to operate in it. You have to go on your own. Well, and we did, but it was really hard. And it wasn't funny when you, for the first time in your life, realized that, oh my God, my parents cannot be the authorities for me because they don't know what to do. It's such a new situation. And it was really constantly this repeating thing, okay, it's our great race, you know, we don't know where, but we are going because somebody promised us a better land, a better life. So we went. And here we have this all-in-one. As I said before to Professor Mazoka, when we discussed a little bit today's lecture, that Roman Przybylski is a person who is combining all those things. In his print you can find a metaphor, in his print you can find the irony, and in his print you can find a very intimate notes about himself, about his own feelings. So Take It Easy, it was made in 1987, and I think, the, you know, of course the phrase Take It Easy is We were just returning from the holidays with my parents. I was at the time 9, and the holidays we took at the seaside, at the Polish seaside. So we were going from Sopot to Gdańsk, and of course later on to our place, to Katowice. And there is this moment between Sopot and Gdańsk that you are going above the roofs. And it was August of 1988. It was this moment when the first workers of the shipyards once again went on strike. They were only sitting on the roofs with huge banners saying, well, we are on strike, in complete silence. And when this train was going above these roofs, I for the first time felt what fear means. It was absolutely awful experience. That's why I underlined that I was 9. Until then, I was absolutely sure that, well, maybe I'm sometimes afraid of something, but you know, the adults are definitely not afraid of anything, because they are adults. Everything will be fine. And in this very short moment, entire train got silent, and then I felt that those people are really feel fear because they remembered how it ended previously, how it ended in 1970 and how it ended in 1980. And even though they were longing for change, they were also very much afraid that this change not only not happened, but that there would be another sacrifice with no winners. So I think that this work is a kind of a metaphor of all those fears that people had inside them. Of course, they can also, those things can also refer to his own anxieties. You know, it's very private and personal. I do not want to go so much in his head at that time. But I think that also it's a good metaphor of what happened to many Polish people. And here again, very good descriptions here at the exhibition, so I don't want to go into Samantha's shoes, because she did absolutely a great job, and I absolutely agree that this was important in this grade, is this moment when the speaker, so the person who probably represents the authorities, is completely anonymous because he doesn't have any eyes or even his mouth are rather like silhouette, nothing more. But the people who are the audience, they really have to say what they believe. You can really feel that they would like to say something. They have some, you know, some thoughts, they have some things on their minds, and they would like to express it rather loudly. I can feel these people like, oh my God, what are you doing? Okay, you can say something, but who? That we are the people, like Valencia one day said, here in America. And then we have the sign in the sky. I think also it will be related to the times of the past and also to the times of the moment when it was made. So this little graph is expressing a kind of expectation that, you know, sometimes we can see signs in the sky and we don't know what they really mean. We would like to imagine that they are good, but just in case, it's better to be not armed, and those men are definitely armed against the sign. And here is, I think, the word that I like the most about those four that we have here, by Roman Żubulski, of course. Previously I showed you Jerzy Dmitruk and the theater scene, the life as a theater. But this one, I don't know how Pino did it, but he really was able to foresee something. Because you can see here the backstage. So this moment when the actors can do what they really, well, they can be who they really are. They do not need to play, they do not need to act. And when I look at this print, I just see the contemporary Polish society. We did a lot of great things. We fought the communism, we've got solidarity, we've got a lot of great rights. writers, some of them got Nobel Prizes, even one got it this year, even also last year, but doesn't matter, she's really great, I recommend it to you. Olga Tokarczuk is absolutely, well, it's absolutely my favorite before the Nobel, my dad. But the point is that when they're just going out of the stage, when we are at the backstage, we just started to fight with one another. We are fighting, you know, against ourselves. And this is really awful. And I do believe that all the generations that went after those who I described you today, so the young students with whom I work now at the Academy and with whom my colleagues work studios at the Academy, that they will be also able to show us what we really are. Because it's not only good to show people that they are brave, fantastic, that they can do good and, well, enormous things, but it is always good when the artist sometimes showing us, okay, you are a great nation, but sometimes you behave absolutely awful, so just rethink it. And before I end, I would also like to point three artists at these exhibitions that weren't included in this presentation. Andrzej Kowalczyk, on my right side and your left side, it's an incredible series. His works are all related to one period in Polish history, to the Warsaw Uprising. This resting place, it's not a resting place that we take because we are a little bit tired and maybe then we move on. It's the final resting place. There is no move. And he made all those works. Here you have two, and there is another small one at the back. He made all of them taking as a base the real photos made during the Warsaw Uprising. So it's not a kind of, you know, fantasy. It's just a reality that I think it's one of the greatest monuments to those who died during the uprising in Warsaw in 1944. And in order not to end with such a sad feelings, I would also like to point, it will be very hard, but you will find them both at the back on my left side. Professor Jan Pamuła, a former rector of the Krakow Fine Arts Academy, and Professor Jerzy Potrzeba, two great abstractionists. Jan Pamuła, he is one of the pioneers of computer art. He was one of the first who went in the late 70s to Paris, to Saint-Georges Pompidou, and he was transferring, together with the programmists, his aesthetics into the algorithm. And it was really great. It was something very informative for the later generations, how we can operate with digitals. It's not necessarily something that we are using the ready-to-be or ready-to-use patterns, but we can also do something with, well, that is basic, the basis of our art and transfer it into the algorithmic world. And Professor Jerzy Potrzeba, who was in the past, he's still alive, don't worry, but he was in the past a great graphic designer. He made the best designs that we sent, that we exported abroad, like the Krakus series, it was all his. But he is still a great printmaker, artistic printmaker, and it is absolutely incredible that he is able to use a geometrical abstraction to express a very inner and deeper feelings that he has. And speaking about the history and past of his family, because almost all the works that he's doing are related to his family as such, to his wife and two sons and now grandchildren, but also the very sad past of his family that was related to Auschwitz and the part of the family didn't return from this concentration camp. They unfortunately passed away there. And after the war, he decided to go to the plastic school, as I can call it. It was the secondary school dedicated to visual arts, because he was looking for the language by which he may express what he felt and may say the story of his family. And I think that he did it in a great way, and he's still doing it. So those two artists I also very much recommend. Of course, I recommend all of them. And once again, I would like to thank you that I can be here, and first of all, that all the people could be here in the past and can be now with his work, with their work. So
Prize at the last trial in 2018,
And she did a project using woodcut, so a very traditional technique, and especially the woodcut matrices. She made 100 touches. By that she meant 100 matrices in the shape of a hand on which she wrote different words. Some of them very kind, some of them rather unpleasant. And then, at the opening and during the exhibition, we have some dates during the exhibition that we can repeat it, but during the opening, there was a man higher by us who was almost naked, and everyone can come to him and put a kind of a print on his body. And it was an incredible experience because those people, at first they were, oh my God, I can do something. Oh, then they start to read the words. And it was, oh no, but I can't just put the word pig on him. It's not so pleasant. And that is the moment when they now very conscientiously try to use this. It was not that easy, like, you know, when you're at the computer. You can just write pig and put enter. Oh, who cares? And there was another moment when a professor Banaszkiewicz, about whom I mentioned today, he tried to choose very carefully, very wisely. So he chose an abbreviation ABC. He didn't know that this is the abbreviation. He just thought that it's the beginning of the alphabet, as we have seen, ABC. And then the artist and said, you know what you just did? Thanks God, it's a man, the one who is standing and you just put this print on him. So, wow, it's just ABC. Well, those are just like, he said, no. In the language of the youngsters in the internet, this means the absolute lack of boobs. Wow. He was so, oh my God, no. This is about what the project is. You didn't know. And you just did not possess it. And we sometimes use the words, well, very willingly thinking that, oh, it's nothing. Well, I just say something like that, oh, it's nothing. But in so we have now so many languages in the internet that in one of those languages it can be something and it can be very harmful. So yes, getting back to the point. There are young Polish artists, not only, but of course also from Krakow, who tries to describe contemporaneity. Of course, the contemporaneity is different today, but still I think that there is this fragility in them. They are very sensitive to what is going on around, and they try to describe it in their works. Right. Any other questions?
Not a question, it's a comment that you have brought together this artwork and your history in a way that very few people in the world would ever do. And I can't thank you enough for sharing.
Yes. Thank you very much. Yes.
Political instability in general, Brexit in the EU, and also really most countries around the world are kind of in this political mode of entering a new decade of seeing what happens. So my question is, how do you see the 2020s in the near future in terms of political work?
Well, I must say that as a historian, I very much appreciate what Romans, ancient Romans, always repeated. The best teacher of reality is history. So I know, even though it's not very nice, but I know that the sinusoid is the only way that really rules the world. So for me, it's nothing new in this what's happening, even though I'm not very much, you know, proud of it. But just, well, that we are going now here and probably we'll be going. spend on this position, that printmaking is a social media in the best sense of the word. So I think that it will survive. I can also, on the other hand, going away from the politics, but I think that printmaking, especially the so-called classical techniques, they will definitely survive, because more and more young people, they are really interested in something material. You know, they were born in the immaterial world, in fact. Well, the palm top, the tablet, everything like that, is almost the first experience that they went through when they were very young. So for them, there are two key, if I'm looking at my students, for example, there are two key features or two key elements that rule now their world. The first one is get rid of the too many things, too many visuality, too many pictures, too many sounds, too many of everything. So we would like to have less. So minimalism is something that is really now on. And other thing is, I would like to do something manual. I would like to do something that it's hard to do. That, you know, to use a medium that will fight with me. Because printmaking is fighting with you. It's not that easy. Probably a lot of you who are here present at least did one print in your life. If yes, you are very lucky. Because it's not an easy thing. Especially when you are doing it for the first time. First thing is, it's very easy to get cut. I constantly repeat to the people who are coming to our center for workshops. The workshops are the linear cut workshops. And I say, okay, here is the tool, and you know what you are doing. This way, not this way. Unless you would like to kill yourself. Of course, there's always at least one person who can do that. So, it's the first hard thing. Another one is, you never know what will happen in this magical in between the matrix and the paper. And there's also a press. There's pressure on the press, everything is there. And the kind of paint you use, everything is important. So for these young people who are, from the very beginning, very much used to the situation that, oh, it's this, okay, and I'm doing this, or it appeared this. Now, they love to make something that is really hard. So this is, for me, another reason why printmaking will survive, no matter what. All right.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.